Hey friends, Cammy here with Our Valley History, where as you know, we make history every day. Today we are out in Kearney Park at the historic Kearney Mansion, where we're going to get to know a little bit about our valley history. All right, friends, let's head inside. Alrighty friends, so we are inside of the historic Kearney Mansion, where tour guide Chelsea Alvarez is going to tell us all about the history of the Fruitvale Estate, and she's also going to tell us a little bit about Emptio Kearney himself. Hey Chelsea, thank you so much for meeting with us today.
Of course, I'd love to be your tour guide and have you all join us as well.
Awesome. So what is the Fruitvale Estate? What's going on with that?
So the Fruitvale Estate here is going to be the grand estate that Mr. Emptio Kearney had here. And back in 1903 is when the mansion was originally built here. So unfortunately, he only got to enjoy 3 years of seeing his estate because he passed away in 1906. But before all of that, his grand Fruitvale Estate, the largest that it was 6,800 acres. From there, the inheritors of the UC system here, they sold off most of the land, so we're left with the 225 acres that the park is here today. But Mr. Kearney had all kinds of grand things here in the valley. He was known as the California Raisin King. That is how he primarily made his fortune in his name here in the valley, and is considered the founding father of sun-made raisin.
Really? So the colony farm system was a way that basically people were coming from all over the country, migrating and immigrating out here, and the Fruitvale Estate was one of those colony farm systems, right?
Yes.
So how did the Fruitvale Estate, how did that work for farmers who wanted to come out and buy property?
All kinds of single families were able to buy property from Mr. Kearney. All they had to put was down payment of anywhere between $100 to $150. They also had to build their own home, just like Mr. Kearney was busily building his servants' quarters, men's quarters, all kinds of things. So all of those farmers, the silver lining being that Mr. Kearney knew a man named Dr. Perrin, who financed the irrigation and canal system created by Moses Church. That way, the following season, those single families would be able to start paying off Mr. Kearney. So this entire mansion cost Mr. Kearney approximately $20,000 to build. A dollar back in 1900, today would be over $100. So you can imagine over $2 million to build a property like this here.
Wow, that's insane. Well, you want to take us on a tour? Show us a little
Absolutely.
Bit more?
Absolutely. I'd love to have you guys here.
Awesome.
Y también se habla español. If you guys want to have a tour here in Spanish, I am your bilingual tourist, and I would love to have you guys here. So let's go ahead and learn more about the Fruitvale Estate here.
Right. Let's go.
Alrighty. Welcome to the estate room. So this is where you're going to primarily learn all about Mr. Kearney's grand estate that he had here. So when you walk in to find the museum here, you won't see all of these buildings that were once here. Unfortunately, they were demolished in 1940, but you'll be able to see all of the different buildings and school children that were once here as well. This is a class from 1935. So there were all kinds of different diversity in how many children and families that were here. And if you ever get lost when you're finding the park here, you can blame that on Mr. Kearney himself and a man named Rudolf Ordrich, who actually designed this entire park themselves. The last person that designed this map was named Joseph Garcia, who actually attended the Kearney Elementary School. We are currently at the heart of the Fruitvale Estate in the center. Just past this winding road to your right is where the chateau that Mr. Kearney was planning to build would have been. That would have been his grand massive castle that was supposed to be at least 5 stories high and have 13 bedrooms. But here, we'll go ahead and see what Mr. Kearney was able to accomplish. So he wanted to pay his workers with his own scrip coin here. So these coins here, he minted and paid his workers with. He had some agreements in downtown Fresno for them to be able to exchange that currency as well. And then Mr. Kearney also had his Armenian immigrant workers on the far left-hand side here that were working inside of our packing house. Our packing house still exists today, and that is where we primarily keep all of our archives here today as well. So directly to our right is where we once had a post office, but what we do still have here would be the carriage house. That is where Mr. Kearney would have stored his locomobile and his Mercedes-Benz limousine, his European car that he had here at one point as well.
It's amazing you can see all the different ethnic communities that were here on the Fruitvale Estate.
Absolutely.
And people were able to immigrate here and migrate here and have a life and have a home and have a way to make a living.
Sure. sure, and Mr. Kearney absolutely understood those hardships. Him being an immigrant from England as well, he knew what it was like because he was actually of Irish descent and the Irish weren't seen too fondly. So he absolutely understood how hard it was to immigrate over to the United States and not be seen too well there. But fortunately for him, he was able to create his mansion that we are currently in and even had grander plans of creating his chateau. But he was considered a fair boss and very good to all of his workers here. So that's why at the peak of the season, he would have approximately 500 employees here at one time. So right behind us here on this cabinet, you'll actually see a photo of his workers drying the raisins. So the season to dry those raisins would be between late August to early September. So unconventionally there, you'll see them drying them on the ground, but usually today you'll find them on vineyards, of course.
So what different types of fruits were the biggest draws at that during this time for farmers, other than grapes?
Of course, grapes being Mr. Kearney's number one, but there were also a lot of communities that were growing peaches as well, and we actually have some of the different crops that were grown here as well. So cotton being a large commodity here, olives were also big for Mr. Kearney. We actually have an olive grove here in the park that used to be 25 acres large. And there's also all kinds of orange groves. It was also very common to have poultry and cotton and all kinds of different crops that were here as well in his Fruitvale estate. So when you do join us for a tour, you'll be able to see what's behind the safe here, why it's so mysterious, and why Mr. Kearney had it there as well.
Okay, well, we'll definitely save that for people to come out and check out. So I'm seeing here that there was a grocery store, the warehouse, packing house, a blacksmith shop, and you said there was a school. So my question for you is, anyone who was on the Fruitvale estate, if they had maybe a fig grove, could they then use the packing house here to pack their figs and then use...
Absolutely. Mr. Kearney was open for business. If there were other families that wanted to be a part of the Fruitvale estate, they were absolutely able to do so. Mr. Kearney also had his own railroad system. So once all of those fruits were packed up in his packing house, he was able to ship them off at his direction whenever they were ready as well.
Oh, that's awesome. Very awesome. And it's my understanding that everything that we learn when we're on tour here comes from Kearney's his papers.
Absolutely, Kearney's journal, all kinds of books that were written because of Mr. Kearney as well.
That's very cool. Living history, gotta love it, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, so I heard last year on one of our ag tours that there's actually three different streets for coming here. One was for horses.
Yes.
One was for walking, and then one
the center for automobiles,
right?
Yes.
And do all those roads still exist?
They do, and so that Kearney Boulevard that you're going to come across when you come into the mansion, it stretches 11 miles long, and it connects Fresno to Kerman. You'll see the iconic palm trees that are there, the oleanders. At one point, there was about over 10,000 of those oleanders as well. So Mr. Kearney has all kinds of trees that are not native to California, such as the Australian eucalyptus tree, and also, most notably, what you'll first find when you come into the mansion would be the bunya bunya trees, also known as monkey pod or monkey tail trees, that he also purchased from Australia for $4 a piece there.
And those are the ones with those big, huge, crazy
pine cones. Yes, in August you'll see those very large green pine cones all over the park here.
Awesome. Well, you want to take us upstairs?
Absolutely. Yeah, let's go. Check it out. So this wallpaper here is actually original. It used to be a dark purple color, but the red dye faded out over time, so we're left with this blue color. Cami, any idea what flower this might be?
Wisteria?
Yes, you are absolutely right. I'm so glad you didn't say grape clusters. Okay, so not to confuse you, but we'll be going into the children's room. So contrary to popular belief, Mr. Kearney actually didn't have a wife or children. So this is actually a reproduction of what the second superintendent's child's room would have looked like. So we have all kinds of fun things here, including these toys, an oak bedroom set. These were all donations to the Historical Society, but you'll find all kinds of different wallpaper pieces that are original and also new For example, behind this white door, you'll go ahead and find the original wallpaper piece of this cabbage rose wallpaper pattern.
No foul.
So it's pretty closely matched to what we have today. And this is where we will also test your knowledge to know if you still recall what a chamber pot and a wash basin is and why they were used. And so we'll be learning more about that as well here. So this would be Mr. Kearney's Jack and Jill bathroom. So he did have modern indoor plumbing as well as the electricity, the different vents he installed. He was actually smart about those vents because he added a drawstring so he wouldn't have to open and close it himself. This here would be the largest claw-footed tub in the home, and it did have hot and cold running water. Now we are headed into one of our loveliest rooms here. This would be the ladies' room. Specifically, this would be Dagmar Frizzell's room. Who was Dagmar? So Dagmar would have been the wife of the second superintendent here. So as we can tell, Dagmar was a very outgoing person here. She enjoyed horseback riding. She was an actress, but she didn't like the long hours of being away from her son and family. So she actually had an art studio here in downtown Fresno. She also had an art studio in the attic of the mansion here as well. So this would be the ladies' room. So her son, Samuel Parker Frizzell Jr., was actually born here in this room. And so back here to our left-hand corner, we'll actually see another photo of Dagmar Frizzell. So when you come into the mansion and there's a roundabout, you'll see a sign that says Lakeview. So that is where Dagmar Frizzell had a pond at one point. So she just took her Instagram photos and had it drained because she didn't like all of the mosquitoes that it was attracting here. So in this room here, so all of the fixtures in the bathroom here are all original.
And it was really uncommon at the time to have both hot and cold running water in a house, let alone two separate bathrooms. But isn't there a third bathroom up here as well?
There actually is.
So this house, well, this mansion had three operational bathrooms, which was totally unheard of for the time, correct?
Yes, and then each room, of course, would have its own closet and all kinds of very spacious areas for them to have as well.
So I've got to ask you, what's with this thing on the wall?
So this would be the push button for the lights here. Do you actually want to try it and see for yourself?
Yeah, sure.
See, so you'd push it there.
Maybe. Nails.
There we go.
Oh.
You see it's a modern, newer way of turning on and off the lights here. We'll just flip it again, and there you go. But here in this room, actually, you'll see that we have some of the buzzers missing. So unfortunately for Dagmar Frizzell, it was considered improper for her to be accompanied by a male servant. So if her husband was in the other room, he would have to be in here with her while she got assistance. But luckily, as you can tell, Dagmar worked around those rules and was able to still be outgoing and have all of the things she was hoping to accomplish as well, being an actress, being an avid horseback rider, and driving as well. So all kinds of things that women didn't typically do at that time as well.
Something very unheard of at the time. I mean, women driving in general before 1940 was uncommon.
This would be her walk-in closet here. This bright red color of the floor is actually the original color.
And these are all donations that have been donated to the Historical Society over the years, right?
Yes. Very similar to what Dagmar would have owned. So you'll be able to get an idea for what the clothing was like back in the 20s and 30s. So from here, we'll be stepping into Mr. Kearney's closet there. You'll see that he has a love for the color green there. He has a trunk there with a K on it. And we have made it to Mr. Kearney's room. So this black and white photo, you'll see black and white photos in all of the rooms that will tell you the original furniture pieces and where Mr. Kearney had originally placed them. So from the room, you can tell that it's pretty much left intact from when Mr. Kearney last saw it in April of 1906. These are photos of Mr. Kearney throughout the years and decades, trying out different hairstyles, but also displaying his wealth, of course. So it was uncommon for someone to take their photographs so often. And then on top of that, he would always use his own suit and not the one lended to him by photographers.
And these are the buzzers that you were talking about, the call
buttons? Yes, these would be the call buttons. So one of these buzzers would lead over to the servants' quarters if you wanted food or assistance, and then the other would lead to a chauffeur if you wanted to get away as well.
Excellent. And you were saying that Mr. Kearney didn't really live here full time. He was traveling back and forth.
He always traveling there, promoting his Fruitvale estate business. That's why he has so many of his original trunks here, to show you that he was always on the move here. So these are actually photos of himself on his European excursions. He was front and center there with the cane. That is where he would go on to England, to France, to Germany, all kinds of different countries to promote his Fruitvale estate business and try to make it as large as he could, because he was the president and founder of the California Raisin Growers Association. And that is how a branch of it became Sunmade as we know it today.
Well, I know in doing research about Kearney, his life here in Fresno, he was very focused on work and trying to get the Growers Association to be successful.
Absolutely, yes.
Sometimes heatedly.
Yes, he sure did.
We'd have arguments trying to get the packers and the growers to come to a cohesive agreement to make it a better system for each of them.
Right, because he had such an expansive vision for what he wanted, and he could envision himself for having here in Fresno. He was hoping to have this large association of all of the growers and raisin growers, because he saw that there was a great opportunity in Fresno with the land being so arid, and it was very barren at the time as well. But he, as you can tell, he created something from the ground up, which is his amazing mansion that we still have here today with us for almost over 120 years now.
That's amazing. You know, I was reading that he, when he would go to New York and then also London, that he was very much the socialite. And
he was.
People here in Fresno didn't believe it because, you know, he was very stern when he was here and very business focused. But when he would go to New York, he'd, you know, be living it up.
He sure would. He knew when to be social and when to tone it down as well. And this would actually be Mr. Kearney's original bed of his.
Okay, wait a second. Wasn't he about 6 feet tall?
Yes, he's supposed to be 6 feet tall, so perhaps he slept diagonally. I'm actually told in some European customs it was common to have shorter beds so that you could improve your posture and sleep upright. And to add to that, he also had his own day bed here, so it was considered rude for Mr. Kearney to undo the bed after the maids had already done it, so he would actually take his naps here.
All right, well, you know me, Chelsea, I'm a huge foodie, so you gotta take me downstairs to the dining room.
Sure, let's go take a look. So past these sliding doors will actually lead into Mr. Kearney's dining room. This is his original table. You'll see that it's seated for four people, but Mr. Kearney did extend it for up to six people. Here he would have his meals with his superintendents, the Frizzells, or also Rudolph Aldridge, to continue discussing plans for the mansion here. So you'll see that this wallpaper is of a golden orange hue, but then I'll let you have a guess as to what chemical in the paint would have made it that original dark green color.
I have no idea.
Any idea? So I'll leave that up to you guys to come tell me what that is.
Very good. And then as soon as they do, you tell me.
Absolutely. We'll make sure that you are in touch with what that is. So because Mr. Kearney wanted to be a part of these aristocratic circles, he actually had a custom-made Majolica bowl here from Italy. So interesting that he would have wanted a bowl like this, because he actually took the temperance pledge at age 14, so no gambling, no smoking, and no drinking, but yet he wanted to have a bowl such as this one to be able to entertain his guests. With Mr. Kearney being the raisin king, of course, he was going to be exposed to wine in some capacity, which is why he also has, for example, a wine cabinet here right behind us. He also, right behind us here, is also going to be his butler's pantry.
So I'm noticing there's no kitchen.
Yes, we are missing a kitchen. So where would that be located? Mr. Kearney, being smart as he was, he wanted to make sure that there wasn't a fire hazard inside of his mansion. So right across this door is where you'll actually find the kitchen in the servants' quarters, a very amazing place where you can see where all of those meals for the 500 employees were made twice daily. So he had all kinds of cooks here, including three Chinese cooks and two Japanese garden takers. He also had the Hollabaugh family that was living in the second story of the servants' quarters as well, to help him run his entire mansion here as well.
All right, you want to go take us over to the kitchen?
Sure, let's go take a look.
Fools rushing where angels.
All right, so we have made it here to the kitchen where Mr. Kearney's 500 employees would have their meals twice here daily. So in a stove, just like this one, is where all of those meals would be cooked. So this is here is not necessarily the original. This one's powered by gas. The original would have been powered by regular wood stove. It also would have taken up this entire platform. Although the hood of the stove here is original and it comes from San Francisco. So the way it would work is that approximately 100 of these meals would be made here. And then they would go down here right behind us to the dumbwaiter. And then from the dumbwaiter, it would go ahead and go down to the basement of the servants' quarters where they would have their meals. They also had the option of having their meals in the tea house. So the tea house is now located towards the front of the park, but it used to be behind the servants' quarters for them to have an extra area to have their meals as well.
I can imagine it would get really hot in here. That's so
cool. Oh, it sure would, right? And that's why Mr. Kearney didn't want to have to deal with the fumes of the food and the fire hazard as well. So he kind of thought of everything as he was building his mansion here.
What's back here, Chelsea?
So this is going to be our exhibit. So currently we have an agricultural exhibit. These exhibits are switched out every 3 months. So you'll learn all kinds of fun things here, such as the infamous Fresno scraper here, created by James Porteous, and it was instrumental in creating the Panama Canal here. And also you'll be able to discover more about raisins. So raisins were actually discovered by accident and originally marketed as Peruvian importations here.
One of the greatest things I think about this space and this is, one, we have so much fun doing the research and we're putting these exhibits together and finding all these images of just not only families that are picking the fruit off the tree,
yes,
showing that it really is a family farm. You know, it wasn't just dad out there working or, you know, whatever.
Everyone pitched in, absolutely.
Yeah.
And that's the best thing about the tours is seeing you guys all come out here and being familiar with all of this history and your families being a part of it and you already connect with it as well. So you'll see more about the history of Sun-Made Raisin and all about the neighboring towns here, such as the beginnings of the city of Clovis and all kinds of different historical figures that were monumental in creating the early Fresno agricultural settlements here.
Well, I mean, just the advancement of technology, of how, you know, they used to use the cradle and then transition to motorized. It's amazing. It's amazing how quickly we advance.
We have come a long way, as you can tell, even with pesticides and all kinds of different equipment. Farm equipment has gone a long way as well.
Well, thank you so much for taking us on a tour. I feel like every time I come into this mansion, I learn something new, even though I work here. So I really appreciate your time, Chelsea. And why don't you tell everybody how they can come out to Kearney Mansion and take a tour with you?
Well, it was a pleasure having you out here, Cammie. So online on our website, Our Valley History, you'll actually be able to book online. You'll also see here on our sign here, yeah, you're able to also walk up and purchase your tickets here as well in the mansion.
And so if you want to learn all about the Fruitvale Estate, Colony Farm Systems, and M. Theo Kearney and his dream of having
its Grand Chateau.
Yes. Then come on out and give Chelsea a visit and support your local history.
We'd love to have you. We hope to see you all soon.
All right. Bye, friends.
Time.